Agenda presents this unabridged recording of The Fictional Woman, written and read by Tara Moss.
Introduction. The year is 2002. I'm 28 years old, and I'm sitting in a small, unfamiliar hotel room hooked up to a lie detector machine. Pneumotubes are wrapped firmly around my chest to measure my respiration, a tight armband sphygmomanometer measures my blood pressure, and a clip pinching the end of my index finger measures tiny changes in my perspiration. Standing over me is a journalist from the Australian newspaper. Across the table is a professional polygraph examiner, a former Victorian police officer who normally tests suspected pedophiles, rapists, and killers. He's testing me to see whether or not I actually write my own books. I worked as a photographic and catwalk model in North America, Europe, and Australia before quitting at age 25 and publishing my debut crime novel. 2.5 years later, as my second novel hits the shelves, the book itself has seemingly been overshadowed by a more compelling mystery. How a model turned author, as I'm frequently dubbed in the press, could possibly write a book. The rumors abound that my novels are heavily edited, that my boyfriends wrote them for me, that I employed a ghostwriter, that they're plagiarized. But the truth is, I've written every day since I was a child, and I've spent hours every day for years now plotting, researching, writing, editing, and laboring over my novels. The rumors are false, but without a strong public voice, social media is yet to exist, I have very little means to defend myself. So when a call came from a journalist asking if I would take a polygraph test to prove that I write my own novels, I replied without hesitation, "Bring it on." More than a decade later, the lie detector test that became a defining moment in my early publishing career feels like the experience of some other woman. At 40, the struggles of my 20-something self to be given credit for writing my own words has been largely forgotten. I am now the author of 9 novels, a blogger, a freelance journalist, a doctoral candidate, happily married, and the mother of a young girl. The 30-page document confirming that I am indeed the author of my own work collects dust in a corner cupboard. Over the years, I've become a big believer in statistics and empirical research. This, I suspect, is the lesson I've learned from my polygraph test, that sometimes cold, hard facts are the only way to break through unfounded assumptions, my own assumptions as well as those of others. They help us to see beyond the biases formed by our own experiences to larger patterns in the world. Here are a few statistics that grab me at the moment. Women comprise 50.2% of Australia's population, but as of 2014, they make up less than 1/3 of all parliamentarians and occupy roughly 5% of all cabinet positions. About 70% of front-page bylines in Australian newspapers belong to male journalists, despite the fact that an equal number of men and women are employed as journalists. During 6 months of US election coverage in national print, TV broadcast, and radio outlets, 81% of statements about abortion were made by men. As of 2010, the National Gallery in the UK had 2,300 works in its collection, of which 10 were by women. In the top-grossing 250 films of 2012, 91% of directors were men, as well as 85% of writers, 83% of executive producers, and 98% of cinematographers. In 2013, the top 10 male actors combined made over 2.5 times more than the top 10 female actors combined. Women working full-time in Australia earn, on average, 17.5% less than their male counterparts. Perhaps my interest in these statistics stems simply from the lived experience of being a woman, or from the fact that I now have a daughter and I want her to have opportunities and a voice. Perhaps my interest in women's representation and the lack of celebrated female writers, journalists, directors, cinematographers, and artists stems from my personal experience of fictions about certain types of women, models, blondes, and the stark disconnect I once experienced between the real and the fictional me, and by extension, I imagine, the disconnect between the representations of other women and the reality of who they are. Perhaps my interest in women's representation in Parliament, and non-white representation, and non-heterosexual representation stems from an interest in seeing a more equitable representation of the community in the parliamentary processes of our democratic country. Whatever the reason, I've taken notice of these facts. I have also noticed something else. A large number of people are dismissive or even aggressive when confronted with statistics like those I've just read. Women are accused of playing the gender card. Time and time again, we are told that advancement in our society depends solely on merit and hard work, that everything is equal now, and that gender doesn't matter. But as long as one gender continues to be paid less, represented less, and continues to be consistently less involved in parliamentary decision-making and public debate, even when it is about their own bodies, we have to conclude that, unfortunately, gender does still matter. There are many important discussions to be had about our society and the world at large. Discussions about the issues facing our children, our seniors, our environment, and the circumstances of those from different cultures and countries, some of which I also write on. But this book is focused unapologetically on the experience of women and girls within the culture I know best. Despite its title, The Fictional Woman is a work of nonfiction. Many of my arguments are based on statistical and media analysis, empirically supported facts and figures, and much of the book draws on personal experiences I have never written about before, some unpleasant for me to recall, and some a joy. Some of the dates are guesses. All of the stories are true. And I wrote them myself. The results of the lie detector proved unequivocally that, shock, I am a writer. Chapter 1. The Model. How ironic this all is. I'm hired for my looks, and yet it takes them 3 hours to make me pretty enough to photograph. Isn't that weird? Supermodel Monica Schnarr, age 15. It was the first day of summer, and I was sitting in the front passenger seat of the family car sipping a Dairy Queen milkshake. The cold of the milkshake froze the metal braces on my teeth, so I had to remember not to drink it too fast. My mother, Janie, was in the driver's seat. We were parked at the scenic lookout at the top of Mount Tolmie, my hometown of Victoria, British Columbia, spread out below us. My mother put down her own milkshake and took my hand. "Tara, is this what you want?" she asked, looking me in the eye. She was not referring to the milkshake, but to the sudden, rather staggering suggestion that I become an international fashion model. In many ways, I was the most unlikely candidate for a model you could imagine. Throughout my childhood, I was what many people refer to as a tomboy. I loved climbing trees and playing with toy cars. It wasn't that I hated feminine things. I just liked cars and horses and spaceships, things that could go fast and take you to exciting places and planets, more than I liked toys that needed to have their hair brushed. I preferred toy monsters to toy kitchen sets. My parents never emphasized that I was different or needed to change my preferences. These choices of mine were not conscious, at least not yet. And I didn't have a problem with girls' clothes, per se. I just hated wearing dresses because they got in the way when I was going places, like up trees. When I was 6 years old, my father took me and my sister to his work picnic. Thanks in large part to my height and the long legs that came with it, I could run faster than most kids my age, and that day I won a running race. I think it was the first time I'd ever won anything. One of the organizers led me to a table marked Girls Age 6 to 8 to collect my prize. The table was covered in wrapped gifts, and fearing I'd be stuck with a toy I would not like, I asked if I could please take a gift from the boys' table instead. The woman bent over and told me quite pointedly, "No, darling, those are for boys. These are the ones for girls." Reluctantly, I took a gift from the girls' table and opened it to find my worst fears realized. It was a Barbie doll. I held the useless doll I'd won, my first prize. "It doesn't do anything," and watched through eyes swimming with tears as the winning boys collected their Hot Wheels cars and train sets and action figures. Thankfully, my mom understood. She wiped the tears from my face and explained that we could make my prize into anything I wanted it to be, anything at all. So when we got home, she helped me to dye the Barbie's blonde hair black and add stitches to the doll's sculpted plastic cheek to transform her into a kind of Vampirella Bride of Frankenstein monster. I loved her. To this day, I wish I knew what happened to that doll. In my preteen years, I became interested in makeup. I was perhaps 12, and I was experimenting with my appearance. Mostly, I wanted to be David Bowie, who, truth be told, I resembled a bit at the time, physically speaking. I had grown up, but not yet out. I was the thin white Duke. In fact, I was so skinny, my dad used to joke that if I turned sideways and stuck my tongue out, I'd look like a zipper. By 14, I was painfully skinny and unusually tall. Complete strangers had taken to commenting that I should be a model. Then my parents watched a TV program about an Ontario girl named Monica Schnarr. Having been discovered at age 13, she was now 16 years old and 6'1" and had already launched a successful modeling career in Europe. Apparently, modeling agencies favored young girls who were tall and slim. The airing of the program coincided with the semi-annual marking of our heights with pencil on the frame of the kitchen doorway. I had surpassed my older sister's impressive stature and cracked 5'11". I was growing fast, and I wasn't finished yet. In fact, I had grown so fast, there were faint stretch marks on the backs of my knees. I was tall and young, but still quite shy and introverted. My parents had noticed that I had started collecting American Vogue, and after watching the TV program, it occurred to them that appearing in a fashion show at the local mall might help to boost my confidence. So one afternoon, my mother took me to a local model agency, Charles Stewart. The reaction of the agent, Corey Paisley, was not at all what we'd expected. He said I had something called it. He said I was just what they were looking for in Europe, and as soon as European casting agents saw me, they would want me to fly to Milan and Paris to work. He urged us to sign a contract and urged me to book in for a modeling test shoot immediately, so they could see how I looked on camera and makeup. It would cost us a lot of money to have the test shoot done, though, he warned. Instead of agreeing right away, my mother played it safe. Surprised and a bit wary, she thanked the agent for his time and left without making any commitments. 30 minutes later, we were at the top of Mount Tolmie, looking over the town I know so well. This was where I had grown up. I could name the streets below. I could see the houses of my friends, my high school, even the hospital where I was born. I'd never been on an airplane, let alone to another continent. The only work I'd done was a newspaper route with my friend Debbie and delivering the local Penny Saver coupon flyer with my mom. My mother hadn't been on a plane either. She had come to Canada by boat from Holland after World War II. Her father, my opa, had been forced by the Nazis to work in a munitions factory in Berlin during the occupation, along with a lot of other able-bodied Dutch men. A baker by trade, he baked bread in the munitions oven to bribe the foreman, got a pass to leave the factory, then stole a horse and cart and galloped past the guards at the checkpoint. He freed the horse in a field and continued on foot, walking nearly 700 kilometers, mostly under cover of darkness, back to his hometown of Numansdorp, a small town south of Rotterdam. There he hid, emerging from the family home only at night, worrying every day that the Nazis would come after him for escaping the work camp. By the time the war was over, their village had been flooded twice and their house was shelled. My oma and opa had 4 children when they departed for Canada. Boats left frequently for Australia and Canada, opa told me, and they took the one to Canada because it left one day earlier. My mom was too young to remember the journey. Is this what you want, to go to Europe? My mother asked me. You want to be a model? She seemed slightly rattled. A career as a fashion model was a far cry from a kid doing a show at the local mall. But I was excited by the idea. I was thinking of those pictures in Vogue, how everyone in them looked so healthy and glamorous and happy. It was the late 80s, after all, a few years before the sad heroin chic look hit. I took another sip of my milkshake, trying to act casual, though my stomach was in knots. "Yes," I said. More than a quarter of a century later, now that I am roughly the age my mother was then, and the mother of a young girl myself, I still remember the look on my mother's face. I wonder sometimes about the fear and uncertainty she must have been wrestling with that day. "Okay, if this is what you want, we'll support you," she told me. "And if they really want you, we shouldn't have to pay them to take your picture. They'll call."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.